So welcome back. So this lecture is in continuation to the last lecture. So we were discussing about the different damping systems, and we were first discussing the air friction damping. One type of air friction damping we have discussed in the last class. What was that? That used a piston and chamber arrangement for causing the air friction damping. Okay. Another type is nothing but a chamber type where the instrument itself, the screen or the chamber of the instrument itself will be an air chamber. Okay, so the pointer will be moving inside the pressurized air chamber. So the what we are seeing through is actually an air chamber where we have the pointer, and the pointer when it moves, the pressurized air will actually give the opposition to that vane or the pointer, so which will be subjected to force of opposition, and that force of opposition will nullify the swings. Okay, so this is another type, but this type of instruments are rarely used because that is very difficult to maintain. Okay, because if the air chamber has some leak, then the instrument becomes a futile one. So that is rarely used. Okay, now another type is actually the fluid friction type damping, where we'll see the diagrams. So this is my spindle. This is my spindle. And when the spindle moves, the pointer also moves over a graduated scale. Now, so beneath the spindle, we have a rotor with so many vanes. So this is the rotor with so many vanes. This is actually the top view, and this is the side view. So this, when the pointer moves, the spindle rotates, the vanes also rotate. The vanes will be rotating inside an oil. Oil, we know, it has some viscosity. Viscosity is actually a friction for the liquid. So this frictional force will be opposing the motion of the vanes. Okay, so there also you can see that the oscillations or the swings about the equilibrium or the steady state point is nullified by the viscosity of the oil. So this is another type. This is rare. This is also rarely used because we have to the instrument itself will be very bulky, and the damping oil we have to maintain it in a disc, and maintenance of such a meter is very difficult, very costly also. Okay, so that is also rarely used. Now, for almost all the galvanometer type instruments, we use eddy current damping. Okay, eddy current damping is another one. that is, you know what is eddy current? What is eddy current? That is, rotational currents will be induced by the magnetic field, and this rotational magnetic field will have its own electromagnetic torque, which opposes the force. So this torque is proportional to the strength of the magnetic field and the current produced. So the There will be a disc, a conducting disc, non-magnetic disc, where the magnetic field over it will cause circulating currents, induce circulating currents in the disc, which will actually generate a torque which opposes the motion of the disc. So that is called eddy current damping. Another commonly used one is electromagnetic damping. What you know, that is when the current coil. There it was for eddy currents, the damping disc was there. Now here a current coil, when the current coil interacts with the magnetic field produced, what happens? A current, when it flows through the coil, it has its own magnetic field. So this magnetic field and already existing magnetic field will interact and produce a torque, and that torque will oppose the motion of the coil. Okay, and this is another type of electromagnetic damping, and this is commonly used in galvanometers. So mainly we have learned about four types of damping. One is air friction damping, second is fluid friction damping or damping using damping oil, then the third one is eddy current damping, and the fourth one is electromagnetic damping. Okay, so these are the three types of damping, and we learned about two types of controlling torque generation, that is one using the gravitational force, the other using a flat springs. Okay, now keeping all this in mind, we are moving to the next portion, that is D. Arsnoval galvanometer. So D. Arsnoval galvanometer is the base for the first main meter in the syllabus, that is permanent magnet moving coil instruments. Okay, I told in a chat through WhatsApp that D. Arsnoval galvanometer you have to revise and refresh and come, because this is actually a topic which you have learned in physics 12th standard. Okay, so D. Arsnoval galvanometer is the base of permanent magnet moving coil instruments, PMMC, indicating analog instruments. Okay, now we have, until this point, we have learned the principle behind the deflecting generation of the deflecting force. What are the different types of controlling torque generations, and what are the different types of damping force generation? Okay, and then we have learned about the different types of supports. Then all those things we have learned. Okay, now keeping all this in mind, just see this galvanometer schematic diagram. So this is the side view and this is the top view. Okay, so just we'll first see the side view. See this one. This one and this one, we have learned that is the first type of support, that is the suspension type support, where here we have a simple ribbon and here we have the coil. Okay, so this is the first type of support that we have learned, that is the suspension type support. Okay, then this is the current carrying coil, which is wound over an aluminium former. So why aluminium former? Aluminium is very light in weight, that is why we are preferring an aluminium former, because our moving system should be as light as possible so that we can avoid friction. Okay, so this is the current coil wound over the aluminium former, which is allowed to move or rotate between two permanent magnets, north pole and south pole. Okay, and here you have the mirror is on the scale, just to avoid the parallax error. Okay, now so this is the width of the coil and this is the length of the coil. Okay, so this is what in crux we have learned in the last two lectures. Okay, now this is the top view, where this is the now you can see that these magnets are horseshoe magnets. Why horseshoe magnets? It will create uniform radial magnetic field. What is the importance of radial magnetic field? The coil and the magnetic lines of force or the field lines will be always orthogonal at every point. Orthogonal in the sense 90 degree at every point. That is the advantage of having radial magnetic field. So radial magnetic field is created by a pair of horseshoe magnets. So this radial pair of magnets will allow to generate maximum torque. So already I mentioned that torque to weight ratio should be as high as possible. So this arrangement will generate maximum deflecting or driving torque. Okay, now we are moving into a small derivation. This derivation also you have learned in the 12th standard physics, that is torque equation. So L and D we have already discussed. Capital N is the number of turns in the coil. B is the flux density in the air gap in Webers per meter square or Tesla. I is the current through the moving coil, that is in amps. And K, we have seen, that is, what is K? What is K? The spring constant. Okay, so we have defined what is spring constant K. We have seen a relation in connection with Young's modulus and all, and that is how K is defined. So K is a spring constant, and theta is the final steady state deflection of the moving coil in radians. So theta F, the final steady state point. We have discussed about the final steady state point, and that is the so when it reaches the final steady state point, it has a deflection, a theta, that is expressed in radians, and that is what is theta F. Okay, now force on each side of the coil. So coil has two sides. Okay, on each side of the coil, this is the force. That is, what is this equation? Force experienced by a current carrying coil placed in a magnetic field. What is the force equation? That is, the principle behind the operation of this galvanometer is, that is, the force experienced by a current carrying conductor or coil placed in a magnetic field. So we have a current carrying conductor or a coil placed between two pairs of horseshoe magnet. Okay, so what is the force experienced by each side of the coil? That is BIL sin alpha multiplied by the total number of turns. Okay, NBIL sin alpha. So we have an advantage that if the field is radial, then alpha is 90 degree. So sin 90 is 1. We have what? Force is NBIL. So this actually gives the deflecting torque. So what is deflecting torque? That is force into distance. What is the distance? That is, D is the distance covered. D is the distance moved. So I multiply NBIL into the distance D. So L into D is nothing but the area of the coil, area occupied by the coil. Okay. So that means NBAI is nothing but the deflecting torque. Okay. Now, where A is nothing but L into D, that is area of the coil in meter per square, and NBA are constants of the galvanometer. So NBA has nothing but the galvanometer constant, and thus is that is also known as galvanometer constant, and otherwise it is also known as a displacement constant of a galvanometer. Displacement constant of a galvanometer. Okay, so this is very clear. Okay, so this derivation we are carry forwarding to the next type, that is the PMMC type of instrument, that is permanent magnet moving coil instrument. Okay, so this is same as galvanometer, the ER Snowball galvanometer. You can see here that instead of a suspension type, most commonly we go for a jewel bearing type suspension that is very strong and robust. So this is the jewel bearing, this is the pivot. Again, we have this jewel here, again we have the pivot, and we have already said that, learned that the pivot carries the current carrying coil. So this is a coil which is attached or attached to the spindle, and which is allowed to rotate between two horseshoe pair of magnets. And on the other side we have springs here. I'll tell what is a spring. So this here we are actually having controlling torque provided by the spring. Okay, naturally spring will be here as well as here. Here it is only shown here, but two springs are there. This is one spring. So here the controlling torque is actually provided by the spring. Okay, and then we have a pointer which is running over a graduated scale, and between we have a mirror to avoid the parallax error. Okay, now we have this on the top view, as the top view. So this is my spring, this is my aluminium former, and this is my coil. Sorry, this is my coil, and this is my aluminium former. So this is my aluminium former. This box rectangular type is actually the winding, current carrying winding, and this is the top spring, which provides the controlling torque. And this is my the balancing weight, which I indicated earlier itself, which is used to used to maintain the center of gravity all along the vertical direction. Okay, and here we have the pointer which is attached to the spindle, which runs over a scale. Okay, and this is my permanent magnet, which is of horseshoe type. Okay, now quickly moving into the derivation. See, this is my derivation. So this is the cut section view. You can refer to that also. I'll be giving the materials. So this is a cut section view. Everything is the same there. But so as I told that this is a spring. One is winding the other or one direction, then the next spring will be wound in the opposite direction. So what is the advantage of that? That is, when the pivot moves, or the when the pointer moves, what happens? One of the spring will be unwinding and the other spring will be winding. Okay, so what happens? Unwinding will have a restraining torque, and the winding one will have another restraining torque. So both these torques will provide a strong controlling torque, which will try to pull back the pointer back to the initial position. I repeat, that is two pair of springs. One is the two orientation of the springs are in opposite direction. That is, when the pointer rotates, one will be unwinding, the other will be winding. So that will provide two sets of controlling torques, which will help to bring the pointer back to the nominal position or to the equilibrium point. Okay, now coming to the derivation. Derivation is very simple. So we have got this one from the galvanometer derivation, that is deflecting torque TD is equal to NB A into DI. Okay, NBLD. So LD is nothing but area, I is the current. So NBA, we know it is G. So we have deflection torque TD is equal to what? A constant. This is a constant, galvanometer constant. So a constant multiplied by current. Okay, so at the steady state point, the controlling torque as well as the deflecting torque are equal. At that steady state point, they are both equal. So what is TC? TC is nothing but K theta. So at the steady state deflection point, both should be equal. Equating these two, deflecting torque is GI and controlling torque is theta, K theta, we get deflection as G by K multiplied by I, or I is equal to K by G multiplied by theta. K is again a constant, G is again a constant, or current is directly proportional to theta. So the deflection of the meter is directly proportional to the current flowing. We can see that it's a linear relationship. So one important point that you have to understand is that this is having a uniform scale, since the relationship is linear. Thank you.